All right, Carolyn, we'll give everybody a couple more minutes to file in before you get started. But why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and what you do for Sotheby's? And go from there.
So my name is Carolyn Nagy, and I am a longtime Philadelphian. My husband, Alex Nagy, maybe some of you know, was a Racquet Club member for the entirety of his life, up until a few years ago when we moved to Ballykinwood. So unfortunately, we're Kinwood Club members, but we hold the torch strong for Racquet Club. For the last 15 years, I've been working for Sotheby's. I am the director of the Mid-Atlantic for them. So I oversee all buying and selling and appraisal activity for and all business development for Sotheby's in New York and London, Paris, and Hong Kong. Out of Philadelphia. But that's sort of a tangent to this actual talk, which is something that I worked on when I was in graduate school. I have a master's degree in 18th century European furniture and decorations. And my master's thesis was on the Elkins collection at PMA. So from that came kind of this deep dive into the Gilded Age of Philadelphia and what people were buying and collecting and entertaining and decorating with during that time period and what that kind of evoked for them and what they were trying to show. So that's how this sort of all came to be and this talk came to be. And I worked very closely with Donna Corbin, who was a curator at the Art Museum, and Kathy Heisinger, and got access to all of their wonderful archives and files. So there's a lot of juicy information that from personal letters and things that, you know, we don't get to see as a general public, but as a researcher, you have access to. So when Caitlin and I were trying to decide what this talk would be about, oscillated between, like, do we talk about the contemporary art market and, you know, the Sotheby's side, or do we do something a bit more academic and fun? And more in keeping with the spirit of the Racquet Club, and talk about Gilded Age Philadelphia. So we kind of settled that we would do that. And we can always do another talk on contemporary art if people are really keen to hear what's going on in the art market, but that's kind of where we are.
Well, thank you again for joining us, Carolyn. I just gave everybody a little bit of the spiel before some folks came on here. Just so you know, we are going to be recording this for playback later for the folks who can't make it live. So if you don't wish to have your face in the recording, you can just turn your video off. But I'm going to hand the host privileges over here to Carolyn so she can get the presentation started. I would just ask you, just keep a heads up. Sometimes people are going to come in a little bit late. So yep. I'm going to add you now as the host and we can get started. All right. Okay. Thanks again, Carolyn.
So I want to share my screen with sound. Uh-oh. Host screen is blocking my ability to do this. Okay, so I'm gonna move you guys over here so that I can actually see my slides. What I will say too is that at the end, if people wanna put their questions in the chat, we can do that, or you can ask questions at the end. The last time I gave this presentation was a few months ago and it ran about an hour. So I'll try to stick to that and try not to go over too much because I'm sure some of you are in the middle of your workday as well. But one other thing I will say about this is a lot of this presentation is focused mostly on architecture and decorations as opposed to paintings. There are a few paintings that creep in, but that's a whole separate topic and a whole separate time. So what I'm showing you here on the screen to start is a painting of Elizabeth Warren Drexel, who, as we know, is the daughter of Joseph William Drexel. Her name was Bessie. And she was another one of these great Gilded Age ladies. She split her time between New York City and Philadelphia, like so many of these women did and these families did. She was a writer and a socialite. And this painting is by the portrait painter Baldini, who did many of the wonderful portrait paintings from this time period. And it was really considered an honor to have Baldini paint your portrait. So this really shows her in her most glorious self and most beautiful self. One other thing I will asterisk too is another great topic from this time period is also the jewelry that people wore. And that was another big kind of the real emergence of the jewelry market. And Cartier and Van Cleef, this is really kind of where they were getting their moments and they're starting Tiffany. So this is also, you have to kind of think alongside of all of this wonderfulness, the glitter and the glamour of this time period. But it wasn't all gold, it wasn't all glitzy. And one of the things that we'll get into a bit too is, kind of what day-to-day people were trying to do as well, and kind of the emergence of the middle class. So that's something else we have to keep in mind is this talk is, you naturally want to talk about the robber barons and you naturally want to talk about the wealth of this time period because it was really kind of the biggest moment in American history for the growth of wealth in America. But this was also alongside of that, the growth of the middle class. So this is really a moment where people who were in the middle class were able to buy houses, furnish houses, and establish themselves right alongside of what they were seeing happening with kind of the society and the elite. These were the celebrities, right? This was our Hollywood. So I'm going to start with two figures who I'm sure will be no strangers to our Philadelphians here. Peter Arnell Brown Widener and William Lukens Elkins. And these are obviously very common names to us, but they were really kind of the two big figures of the middle late 19th century in Philadelphia. They were considered robber barons. So they were considered kind of the new money. And in 1902, there was an article written by Herbert Crawley called Rich Men and Their Houses. And he described these men as such. In intellectual, artistic, and moral affairs, he lives by tradition alone. He does not try to cover up his sense of his own newness merely by vulgar ostentation, or as he perhaps would in older and aristocratic country, but an attempt to buy his way into society. What society wants, he has. He wants to make that past something to be seen and felt. He and his family are frequently abroad. He often becomes an ambitious collector of pictures, of objets d'art, and particularly of all aesthetic matters. He wants things with a European reputation. And that's really kind of the birth of this movement artistically and culturally in America. So prior to that, we were really kind of all things American. So you think of, American furniture, American decorations, but this is really the moment where these new moneyed individuals are looking to Europe and trying to emulate what was going on over there and what the princes and the kings were doing because they had now the wealth that rivaled princes and kings. The Widener's fortune came from transportation, as we know. And while his fortune grew, his political clout grew as well. He was appointed city treasurer in 1873, which allowed him to really kind of safeguard and establish his businesses. He also was one of the original founders of US Steel. And that allowed his influence to stretch not only through Philadelphia, but also through Pittsburgh, Chicago, and New York City. And he was quickly named one of the richest Philadelphians of his generation. He was also considered kind of the Richelieu of the transportation system. And Richelieu, who many of you may know, was a 17th century advisor in France who really was responsible for kind of pulling together the court and expanding the court's influence across Europe. And Widener was close friends with William Elkins, who was also in transportation. He was a traction magnate. And together they forged both business and social relationships, including the founding of the Philadelphia Traction Company in 1883. And they worked together to really kind of build out the large tracts of rural Pennsylvania and bring the railway system to there and the transportation system. So transportation including beyond railway, but also cable cars, motor cars, et cetera, et cetera. And the trolley lines, of course, too. Elkins and Widener translated this financial success into their political and civil positions. And they also were really responsible for bringing the International Exhibition to Philadelphia in 1873, and were deeply involved in the one in Vienna in 1900 as well. So this is, again, these kind of cultural moments that were brought to America and that Americans were able to experience that highlighted what was happening in Europe. This wealth obviously translated into social status. And one of the ways that you gained your social status was by, and still perhaps can be noted as, was attending the Academy Ball. And this was one of the first real society events that was established for all these old moneyed Philadelphians. So if you as a new moneyed Philadelphian were able to gain entry into this event, then you've really made it. These were invitation only events, they still are actually. And it was really kind of the elite moment. The Assembly Ball was a white tie affair that was held annually in Philadelphia during Christmas. Guests were invited based on social standing, familial associations, and above all else, wealth. It was established in the winter of 1748 and is the oldest subscription dance still in existence in the United States. The Academy of Music, which is where it was later held, was built in 1855 and it is still the oldest opera house in the United States, which is obviously what I'm showing you here, the Academy of Music. Very rarely were the new moneyed people invited to these events, but Elkins and Widener were based on their standing within Philadelphia political society. And the real New York counterpart to this was Mrs. Astor's annual ball. Elkins and Widener also became members of the Union League, which was another place that really secured their social standing in Philadelphia. The social register was also developed in the 1880s and identified those who belonged to society and those who did not. And the first volume appeared in 1887, which was devoted to New York City, listed less than 200 families. And by 1890, it had expanded to include Philadelphia and Boston. So these were really the moments kind of where you were able to shine and people would look you up to see, you know, are you part of society? Should you be included in events and should you be welcomed at the right tables? The Academy of Music, some few other kind of fun things about this. In 1891, Tchaikovsky conducted the Nutcracker here, the orchestra, obviously, not the ballet. And in 1889, Penn played the Riverton Club of Princeton inside football the Academy of Music. They put down seats over the floor. And so I thought that was kind of fun and what a great, oh, and the score was 0-0. So not maybe a successful football event, but certainly kind of interesting inside of this grand opera house. The Racquet Club is, I don't know if you guys are seeing this. The Racquet Club was another place where people kind of gained their social entree. And the Racquet Club, as you all are probably very keenly aware, was founded by George Widener, PAB's son, in 1889. And it was built by the architect Horace Trumbauer. And we're going to come back to Trumbauer quite a bit because he was really one of the most important architects of the Gilded Age period. In Philadelphia, New York, and in Newport. But the Racquet Club was another place of social acceptance. It was a place that more welcomed the new money than, say, the Academy of Music and the Academy Ball. But this was just another social club. And the partnership between Widener and Elkins was not only a business partnership, but proved to be a familial partnership. So when George Widener asked Eleanor Elkins, the daughter of William Elkins, to marry him, that was really solidifying the importance of this family within Philadelphia. The New York Times called it, they called their marriage on November 1st, 1883, the union of two of the largest fortunes in the city of Philadelphia. So it really got attention beyond our city and was really noted within the Society of New York. The second generation, so Eleanor and George, of the Gilded Age profited from the financial windfalls of their parents, but also the social standing of their parents. Unlike the first generation, the second generation selected their mates based on society position and for dynastic reasons, not specifically out of, you know, one would think love, but it was more about who's who and what families could align themselves. So again, we're looking back and thinking about courtly Europe. So this is something that we saw for generations and for decades and hundreds of years in Europe, but now is really becoming important to Philadelphia and important to Americans. George worked in his father's office and he quickly rose through the company and earned the respect of his community. And he managed, then eventually took over all of his father's holdings and all of his business interests. He also was very interested in the arts and he was a director at PAFA. He was a member of the Union League, as we know, the Racquet Club and Philadelphia Country Club. Women, which part of this talk is really going to focus on women and the role that women played. While the men were the ones obviously earning the fortune, it was really up to the women who they were married to spend the money, establish themselves and really keep their foot in society. So it was really up to the women to plan the balls, to plan the dinners, to execute them in a manner befitting their position, and also to buy furniture, furnishings, and art that would reflect their status. So they were really the ones who created the taste and showed the prosperity of the family. Mrs. Astor, obviously being the most important woman in this time period. And in 1872, the Home Journal described her her schedule as such. Mrs. Astor is more methodical as to her movements. Each winter, she gives a series of dinners and one large evening reception. She away sails for Europe the last week in February. In Paris, Mrs. Astor has a beautiful apartment on the Champs-Élysées, where in early spring, she gives a few dinners, perhaps a musical. She returns the first week in July when she goes to Newport. She opens her townhouse in New York in November. So you can really get a sense of this. This is the movement of these families. And how they spend their time and what cities are important to them. And Paris being the most important European city and for culture and the arts. And both New York and Philadelphia families maintain this sort of the same level of travel schedule and of society movements. When George and Eleanor married, they moved into Linwood Hall, which you see on the right. And Linwood Hall was the home of the Widener family. Wasn't a far stretch for Eleanor to come. She came from her house in Elkins Park as well, called Elstow. And both of these homes were built by the architect Horace Trumbauer and really executed by him. And it was at Linwood Hall that Eleanor really became exposed to Trumbauer. It's where she also became exposed to decorators. The Philadelphia Inquirer described Linwood Hall as dripping with silk, velvets, and gilded moldings, the rooms furnished with chairs from Louis XV's palace, Persian rugs, Chinese pottery, the halls crammed with art by Raphael, Rembrandt, El Greco, Van Dyck, and Donatello. And both of these houses were built of limestone, which was really of the moment classical architecture. And I'm gonna come back a little bit to this, but this was the palatial living of these two families. Okay, so now let's see if we can get this to work.
The book Beaufort's house was one of the few in New York that possessed a ballroom. Such a room, shuttered in darkness 364 days of the year, was felt to compensate for whatever was regrettable in the Beaufort past. Regina Beaufort came from an old South Carolina family, but her husband Julius, who passed for an Englishman, was known to have dissipated habits, a bitter tongue, and mysterious antecedents. His marriage assured him a social position, but not necessarily respect. Archer had not stopped at his club, as young men usually did, but came directly to the Beauforts. He wanted the announcement of his engagement to divert gossip away from the Countess and show his most ardent support for May and her whole family. The Beaufort house had been boldly planned. Instead of squeezing through a narrow passage to get to the ballroom, one marched solemnly down a vista of enfiladed drawing rooms. But only by actually passing through the crimson drawing room could one see the return of spring, the much-discussed nude by Bouguereau, which Beaufort had had the audacity to hang in plain sight.
Good evening, Captain. Good evening, Mr. Archer.
Archer enjoyed such challenges to conformity in private, but in public he upheld family and tradition. This was a world balanced so precariously that its harmony could be shattered by a whisper.
Okay. Okay. So I love that clip from the movie The Age of Innocence, because I think it so accurately describes the feeling of what these homes were trying to evoke and show, and what they were honestly used for. The Age of Innocence, as you all I'm sure know, was a book that was written by Edith Wharton in 1920. So she was really a contemporary of this time period. The book was set in around 1870 New York. It was originally published as a four-part series in the Pictorial Review. And then it was turned into a book. Interestingly, Edith Wharton was the first woman to win a Pulitzer Prize, and she won it for that book. So I love that clip, because it really brings to life her words. And though the narrator who was describing everything was whoever just joined, if you wouldn't mind muting yourself, I think that would be helpful. It was really describing the words that Edith Wharton wrote in her book. So it really gives you kind of this visual representation of all the glamour and the really programmatic way that people decorated their homes. The one thing I don't love about the movie is that they talk about this great Bouguereau. The Bouguereau, The Innocence of Spring, was actually painted in 1886, and it hangs in the Jocelyn Museum of Art in Omaha. So if you want to go see it, you can, but the painting was a bit later, but those were the kinds of paintings that you would see. You would see these sort of old master realist paintings. That was really what was hanging on the walls amidst all of this beautiful furnishing. And the success of these parties was really what made the different families, and the way that you decorated and the layout was really quite important. And we'll come back to kind of this, the idea of this European sense of the unfilotted rooms, that'll become a bit more clear as we go along, and you, I can show you some floor plans. But so the question remains kind of, why was this style and this this way of building your homes, decorating your homes, collecting, why did they look back to the French style as opposed to maybe the English style? And a lot of it came out of the idea of replicating what was happening in courtly France in the 18th century. And even Edith Wharton, who wrote extensively about this, she said it was not until the social influences of the reign of Louis XIV were fully established that modern domestic life really began. So this is really where the last time great money and great wealth existed was 18th century France. And so now we are another period of great money and great wealth. And so what do we look at is the precedent before, which we see is now the 18th century French look. And this also came out in the Centennial Exhibition of 1876 and the Columbian Exhibition in Chicago in 1893. These were really moments where the kind of the earlier chaos of the 19th century, so the blending of styles, the use of all of these different architectural moments really came through and were organized and were rethought. And it was seen a kind of this classical French architecture and classical decoration, and French decoration was really the order of all the chaos that kind of existed from about 1810 to 1870. And architects really glommed onto this as well. And Frederick Lewis, who was one of the bigger well-known architects in America, he wrote an article called The Big Change, and he described the trends of the period as the American millionaire wanted to live like a prince. And since princes were foreign and princely culture was likewise foreign, he must show his princeliness by living among foreign furnishings, foreign works of art in a great variety and profusion as one could be managed. And part of this also came out of the fact that in France, there were politically a lot of things happening. And a lot of this material kind of got thrusted onto the market by the destruction of the Hotel Particuliers and the creation of these grand boulevards that we now know Paris today to look like. All of this was happening at the same time period. So all of these great houses and all of these beautiful things that were happening in France were being destroyed in an effort to widen the roads and make these kind of grand boulevards. And as a result of all this destruction, there were lots of furnishings and decorations that were just tossed aside and available to the market. Why didn't the French just buy these things up? Because this also at the same time, you have to remember, France was also politically in chaos. They were on the brink of a revolution as well. And a civil revolution. And as a result, their financial structure was just an utter mess. So it allowed for these other bigger families, European families, American families like the Rothschilds and the Morgans to come in and scoop up all this material and get it on the cheap. And they did so and furnished their own homes in that way. It was really the Rothschild and they were one of the bigger families that really started to take notice of the 18th century French decorations and redecorate that in this style. And what I'm showing you here is the Wallace collection, which was very influential to Americans. So another part of this grand boulevard transformation, all of which was coming out of the Industrial Revolution, was the creation of steamship travel. And what that did was obviously allow Americans to get to Europe faster and in a much easier capacity. So they would take to what was obviously known as the Grand Tour and go, part of a young man's education was to go to Europe, see the great cities, see the great museums. And part of that was also to see some of these wonderful collections. And they flocked to Europe to do this. Henry Clay Frick and Mellon did their tour together. And they went on a joint trip to celebrate Frick's millionaire status. In London, he went to see the Wallace collection and he described it as, after seeing the Wallace collection, Frick confided to a friend, "The American people are fond, and properly so, of going to Europe, chiefly to see the famous paintings and other works of art there. I'm going to try to bring some of them here, where all Americans may have the opportunity of seeing them without crossing the ocean." So there was really kind of a purposefulness of this, is to see what was going on over there, but then to bring it back to America and make it much grander, much larger. The other part that it's for anyone who is a lawyer on this call might find interesting is that in 1909, the import tax also changed and allowed all of these works of art to come tax-free to the United States. So that was really another moment where all of a sudden now these things could be brought with no tax consequences. So again, was the Payne bill in Congress. And again, this kind of opened this material up. So while this is all happening and people are going, these robber barons are going to Europe to buy these European furnishings and to buy these old master paintings, you also have to remember that this is also the time when Albert Barnes was living in Philadelphia and also buying and kind of looking to Europe, but doing it in a much more contemporary way. Barnes sent Glackens to Europe with $20,000, and Glackens came home with 33 paintings by Cezanne, Van Gogh, and Picasso. So that weren't prized and worth nearly as much as what Frick and Mellon and Morgan were buying. But as we know now today, these are the things that are excessively valuable. But this is what was contemporary and this was happening. Barnes was not a robber baron. Barnes was really more of an upper middle class person. And he, you know, wasn't trying to emulate something that was emblematic of the princely courts. He was just more looking at what was happening in his contemporary world and painting of the contemporary moment. Same with Judith and Leo Stein, another great collection. So Morgan was on this trip and he also looked at all of this and felt compelled to bring it all back and create an exhibition in New York for everyone to see. And he described his collecting habits as, "I heard that Mr. So-and-so had a certain object in his collection that I was very anxious to secure. And in the hope of being able to buy it, I obtained an invitation to visit the collection, which I had never seen. But when I saw what treasure the man had, I said to myself, what is the use of bothering about one little piece when I might get them all? So I asked him at once if he would take so much for his entire collection. He said he would. I bought it then and there." So this was really the 1907. He went to Europe and he bought up all of these great collections and brought them back to the United States. He subsequently donated them, some of it, to the Metropolitan Museum of Art and allowed them to display it so that people could come and see what this material was. And this really was another moment when Morgan did this and he created these exhibitions. These were really moments when people could come and see collecting and see what the tastes were and what the fashions were. And he really influenced a lot of people. And then transported it to other major collections. This was also a time when being successful and who was not. This is also a time when we see Michael Knoedler, who was a paintings dealer in New York, and then Durand Ruel, who was the famous dealer for the Impressionists in Paris. And, you know, if any of you attended the exhibition that PMA did, I think it was several years ago, about 2015, that really showed the paintings in our collection. Was happening in Europe in the 18th century. So on the right, you see Marble House, which was built by Richard Morris Hunt, and is a direct reflection of the built in the mid century in Paris, architecturally at what was happening in Europe in the 18th century, as well as the floor plans. And a lot of these architects like Hunt, Fred White, they studied in the Beaux-Arts, they studied in Paris, they went there. So they were very familiar with this building style, with this material limestone again. They were very familiar with the decorations and the appointments of these architectural elements. Horace Trombauer was not. He was not a wealthy comfortable. He merely established himself by apprenticeship. The Vanderbilt were the ones who built these kind of new big houses, or welcomed Richard Moore and Sanford White to build kind of the first house in Newport. But it was and other New York families that hired Horace Trombauer to build their houses for them, style of architecture. And he was very well respected. We already discussed the Racquet Club was built by him. And he really became well plan, as you can see, utilizes this idea of the enfiladed rooms. So instead of passing through a series of rooms, there is one grand corridor of rooms. So when all the doors are open, you can see through the entire house. And it's this idea of progression and movement through the house so that you can experience the entirety of the house. It also, this architecture really brought together the gardens and the home. So they were all seen as an intertwining working, and you would establish your main rooms, as you can see the salon up here on the top was really the main room for entertaining, and it led to these wonderful gardens. Again, this was all very much established at Versailles with Louis XIV, and this is how his house was laid out in this H plan and what he was doing and how he commanded his residence. So this is now what we are looking at as sort of the pinnacle of opulence and decoration. As I said before, the destruction of these Hotel Particulier in Paris to create the Grand Boulevard provided these dealers with a lot of material to thrust at Americans. And part of that was what is called the boiseries. So these decorative wall panelings. I don't know if you can see my pointer here, but these decorative wall panelings were very much brought to the United States so that we could install them in these wonderful homes. And again, through architectural elements, create these palatial looking rooms. And it was very much their intention to mimic these spaces, but also to create rooms that you could easily move through and move around. So as you can see, the furniture is kind of pushed to the sides and pushed to the walls so that one could entertain well. And this room was used by Eleanor for her annual tennis week ball. So the furniture was spaced accordingly so that people could use the space more as a ballroom than anything else. But the furniture inside, which I think is so interesting, she really relied on Carlin and Duveen. Duveen was another dealer who was focusing mostly on furniture and decorations of the 18th century period. And he really was responsible for working with Eleanor Elkins and helping her kind of find all of these things and telling her what to buy. And part of what she bought was from that J.P. Morgan collection. So when Morgan died, his son, I think his name is Jack Morgan, sold off part of the collection in order to pay down some of the estate debt. And he sold about $4 million then in 1950 to Frick and Widener and Rockefeller. So many of the pieces in this, in Eleanor's collection came directly from J.P. Morgan. So we're now again talking and establishing this idea of provenance. So where did things come from? Who owned them previously? And establishing kind of the importance of these previous collectors and why that was, what that would show to your peers by buying these things at the same time. Eleanor spent to decorate Miramar, she spent just about $1.5 million. So think about the money in that time, that was quite a bit just to decorate the main rooms of this house. The decoration halted for a period in 1912 when she and her family went to Europe and they were sailing home on the Titanic. Eleanor's husband, George, and her son, Henry, both perished on the seas. Eleanor escaped death. She boarded boat number 4 with the other first-class women. The Washington Times actually highlighted her as a hero, claiming that, according to another passenger on board, a family friend, Mrs. Widener did not want to go and asked to be allowed to stand by her husband. However, Mr. Widener told her to save herself and forced her almost to seek the lifeboat. Mrs. Widener kissed her husband goodbye. He told her not to worry, as it was possible that all would be saved and that danger did not yet seem great. So she returned to Philadelphia. Unfortunately, her husband and son did die. But as a result, she inherited the millions of dollars that her husband had. He bequeathed 1/3 of his estate to her, and in addition, all of their personal property and household things. Part of the money that was from the inheritance, Harry had instructed would go to a library, and again, they used Horst Trumbauer to build this library up at Harvard. That would be in his memory, because that books were the thing that he loved the most, and that's what his will declared, that he wanted a library in his memory. At that time, at the dedication of that library, Eleanor met another man, Dr. Alexander Hamilton Rice. And newspapers, as they did then, quickly speculated that the two of them were together. This was, of course, denied. But in April, it was speculated that they were together. It was denied. However, by October, they were engaged. And Dr. Alexander Hamilton Rice was the grandson of Massachusetts Governor Alexander Hamilton Rice. he was also a descendant of one of the first families off the Mayflower. So he actually had all of the pedigree that the Elkins and the Widener family did not. So it was considered a good marriage. And she, as a result, basically gave up her Philadelphia residence, spent most of her time in Newport, and then they built together a house in New York City, since that was where he felt more comfortable. He actually spent a lot of his time on expeditions in South America. And so she, who did accompany her every now and again, she would, but most of it, he was down there. She was up in New York and in Newport, hosting society and really establishing herself there. And he was off on his trips and kind of left her alone to do her thing. So again, we see kind of this triumphant woman coming out and holding the position of the family and establishing all of their societal relations. This also was the time that finished Miramar, and then once that was finished, they moved and built a house in New York City. Again, we see the Vanderbilts are kind of leading the trend and leading the architectural evolution of New York City. The Vanderbilt family built a series of homes with the help of Richard Morris Hunt and McKinney and White in New York City on Fifth Avenue. They were the first ones to kind of move uptown from downtown. Prior to the 1870s, the most fashionable people lived in Washington Square. But then as the Vanderbilts and the Astors moved themselves up further, they established kind of the Murray Hill area. They did continuously compete with each other for the biggest and best. And they did create this series of homes in the kind of the 50s block that were seen as the grandest houses in New York City at the time. Not everyone. I will say, actually, I will pause and say that the grandest palace of, that was considered in 1910, the grandest house of New York City was one created for the home of James B. Duke. Again, created by Horace Trumbauer. This was seen as kind of the largest house at the time. And again, created in this sort of 18th century French revival style, filled with 18th century French furniture. And I also love this house because I think it looks, it really kind of also shows the architecture that we see on the facade of the Racquet Club. And so you can see this look is really expanding beyond Philadelphia and Newport and is now fully integrated into New York City. Not all Philadelphians had large palatial mansions. Most had what are considered townhouses. And here I'm showing you the elevation and facade architecture of Eleanor Elkins Widener Rice, now's townhouse, again designed by Horace Trumbauer. And these were really meant to mimic the idea of the 18th century Hotel Particulier, which again was a French townhouse. On the outside, limestone, very grand, and the inside, you progressed through to an inner courtyard and had your own sort of privacy courtyard. And then the rooms were set up in this enfiladed organization and allowed for great parties. This is very much what we saw in the Beaufort House. This is what it would look like. And Carolyn, her decorator, took these cues again from what was seen in 18th century and decorated the interiors in the same manner. So this is now the interior salon of Eleanor Elkins Widener Rice's New York City townhouse, very much in the same manner as we saw in Miramar. And again, she used the same decorators, the Duveen, to buy the furnishings. And here it was a more intimate space. It was less about entertaining grand balls, more about conversation and having people over to sit and talk together. So symmetry was very important to her. It was very important to the period. And so you can see that what's happening on the left side of the room is mimicked on the right side of the room. Everything is in pairs. That was very important. So, you know, when you think through this, you also have to think then you have to buy everything double. So you have to find things that are paired together, find chairs that are made by the same maker and are sold in pairs. So this was also quite costly and quite expensive and filled to the brim with furniture and decorations. Not all furniture had to be period 18th century furniture. We're now seeing a kind of a moment where reproductions were okay if it's in an effort to achieve what you're trying to achieve. Elsie DeWolf was a decorator at that time, one of the first women decorators of the time. And she wrote a book called The House in Good Taste. And she wrote that she is not one of those decorators who insists on originals. I believe good reproductions are more valuable than feeble originals unless you are buying your furniture as speculation. Modern technology played a really important role also in this time. So we have electricity, we have hot air registers, and these were things that needed to be incorporated into these newer townhouses. And the furniture and the boiserie, these wall panelings needed to reflect that as well. I apologize for the poor quality photos. These were, I took many, many years ago before digital photography, and I took them at the art museum, but I wanted to really highlight kind of the look of this 18th century bags chandelier, now electrified, and how they incorporated the hot air register into the boiserie. So they had to cut out that panel in order to be able to add that. And again, there is a letter. So there was this wonderful letter in the collection archives that described Carolyn talking to Eleanor about these hot air registers. And he writes, "As regard to hot air registers, this concerns primarily New York. I find that these look very much better when they occupy a complete panel. The Seligman console, which is the one of the pieces of furniture that we placed there originally, did not hide these registers and they spoiled the effect of the console tables, whereas they would not have been an eyesore had they been placed in the small panels left and right as we did in the dining room. A commode is now placed in front of these registers." So having the technology and the innovation of the early 20th century was important, but you know, wouldn't want to ruin the aesthetic of the look. So that was something else that they really wanted to maintain was the look. Elsie DeWolf wrote, "When all is said and done, we must come back to wax candles for the most beautiful light of all. Electricity is the most efficient. The candlelight is the most satisfying. For a drawing room or any formal room where a clear light is not required, wax candles are perfect." So this is all new to them. And you know, for those who watched Downton Abbey, you saw how all of this was incorporated over time and the immediate resistance to it all. But now, you know, you didn't want to be behind the times. You wanted to actually have all of this, but again, not ruin the aesthetic while you were doing it. To decorate her New York City townhouse, she did so between about 1923 and 1925. She spent on the furniture alone $1.8 million. So again, huge sum on this. Eleanor died in 1937 and she bequeathed her drawing room, this room, to the Philadelphia Museum of Art and all the furniture inside to the Philadelphia Museum of Art so that they could replicate it there. When she died, the newspapers reported her net worth somewhere between $5 million and $50 million. Her will specifically said that she wanted her archives and this material to go to the Philadelphia Museum of Art, this room specifically. And her death was really seen as one of the most important, unfortunately, but fortunately, one of the most important society events was attending her funeral. She was very well established in these three major cities. and was really seen as sort of the grand dame of these cities. And so many, many, many people, including the Dukes, the Wentmores, the Vanderbilts, they all attended her funeral to pay respects. And the museum, so you can go to PMA and you can see this all. It's still very much intact. This is a picture that I took in the room. They replicated the way that her drawing room was precisely. A few boiseries are not used just due to the space, but the tapestries, the corner panels, all the furniture and decorations is exactly how she had it laid out. And you can go and see it and see how this material really shows what these women and these families were trying to achieve and how they lived in this time period. So one of the questions I get asked all the time is, what happened to Linwood Hall and Elstow Manor, the Widener and the Elkins houses? They still exist today. They've fallen into great disrepair. I think both at one point were bought by either by religious organizations. I think one was used as a convent, one was used as a seminary at one point. They are basically abandoned and have, I think they can even might be possibly for sale. Some of the mansions still exist. Obviously, you can go to Newport and you can see the breakers. You can see many of the mansions. Miramar is a privately held house, so that is not available for view, although the family that owns it, I do know, and they spent a great deal of their time, the Ford family, trying to restore the house. Not quite sure how successful they've been, but they have been trying very hard to do that. Many of the New York City homes were destroyed to make way for skyscrapers and modern buildings. The Frick Mansion obviously still exists. That was built specifically for the collection. And Henry Clay Frick really wanted to maintain his house and his collection. So he built his home to be set up that way, very similar to Barnes. The most notable that is still, most notable Gilded Age mansion that still exists in New York City was the Morton Plant Mansion. And this was diagonally across from those series of Vanderbilt mansions that have since been destroyed. This is now the home to Cartier. So they subsequently bought the mansion and turned it into their global headquarters. Other kind of secondary houses that I love, if you want to kind of really experience this, is Hillwood. Hillwood is the home of Marjorie Merriweather Post and of the Post serial family fortune. She established her home, Hillwood, in about the 1950s in DC, but she very much decorated and kept this a Gilded Age look, and you can tour the house. It's beautiful. The furnishings and decorations are beautiful. Her jewelry is also on view. So for those women who are on the call who like that sort of thing, this is one of the great, great, great houses that not too many people are aware of that I love. So I recommend that you get down there. And then for those that really want to kind of embrace their inner Gilded Age self, Julian Fellows is doing a new show on the Gilded Age in Newport, and he had a casting call, I think it might even still be going on, for extras for their show. So I put up the ad here in case you want to go and log on and become an extra, but it's really kind of a wonderful time period, and it often gets swept under the rug a little bit for more political things that are happening. But it's been a great, great fun doing all of this and kind of digging deep into what Philadelphians and their peers were like during this time period. So I thank you. I think I'm just about an hour and I will stop sharing my screen. Okay.
Thank you, Carolyn. That was fascinating. Does anybody have any questions for her?
Yes, Sandra.
Hi, I live in Elkins Park, a stone's throw from Linwood Hall and Elstow. And Elstow is under renovation as a hotel, which is
wonderful.
And Linwood Hall, I've heard from some of the township people that the New York minister who has owned it for decades is finally considering putting it up for sale. And I know that over the years, various people have gone through it to renovate it. But about 15 years ago, when the Dominican sisters still had Elstow, I had the opportunity to go inside and it was very much intact. So that was good. So we'll see at that point, the nuns who were in charge there said, she said, we have 42 acres and rose gardens and things that we were there to see. So she said, and I'm in charge of the house and the gardens. And I used to have a staff for each, but now it's just me and a staff of two. And we're in charge of both. And by the way, I'm going to be 85 next week. She told me so. But she said the only thing they sold were some candlesticks that next to the, you know, that surrounded the fireplace. But, you know, so we're hopeful that it will, you know, really be a special place.
Yeah, that would be wonderful.
And there's another house that you didn't mention. There's Elstow and Linwood Hall, but next to Elstow is a very large Tudor style house. And that was, I thought that it was Eleanor's in-laws who built Linwood Hall. So she grew up on one side of the street, he grew up on the other. And then that, I guess when they got married, they moved to the bigger house. But.
Oh yeah, I mean, there are all these wonderful mansions that are kind of floating around. Some of them still exist, some of them don't. Some of them have been repurposed, you know, into universities and other educational facilities, because really what else is there to do with some of these larger houses?
Yeah. Would you be willing to share that great photo you had of Linwood Hall with the gardens intact? That was
great. Oh yeah, there's a wonderful book written by Michael Catherins on Horace Trumbauer's architecture, and it has beautiful pictures in it. So that would, I think that's where I got a lot of the pictures. You also have to excuse, I mean, I wrote this my book now nearly 20 years ago. So this is all before digital technology.
Yeah.
So some of those were scanned and old pictures, but yeah, you can find them in that book.
Okay, great, thank you.
So I just have a minor point. I'm not sure if I heard it correctly, and if I didn't hear it correctly, then I apologize. But I believe you said that it's correct that the Racquet Club was established. Racquet Club of Philadelphia was established in 1889. However, the Trumbauer Clubhouse wasn't built till 1906.
Correct. Yes.
I wasn't sure if I heard that correctly or not.
I didn't say it. So the Racquet Club was established, I think, on like 9th Street or like or 6th Street or something like that. And then when George really took charge of it, he then commissioned Trumbauer to build the facility that you guys now have today, and that was done in 1906.
So great event, great seeing some familiar faces out there, people. Nice to, I know that Ken has a question also, so.
Are the panels applique over canvas or plaster, or is the molding direct to plaster or lathe? I'm curious. Okay, so like the boiserie panelings?
Yes.
Yeah, so that's actually carved and painted wood.
So I have a 1912 Trumbauer house and it's canvas over the plaster, and it looks like then it's glued applique, although it is carved wood.
The boiseries that were taken directly from the 18th century houses were carved and painted wood, which is why they can come off.
So because I'm in a spec house, which is at Ardmore, which is the Mitchell house in the voir of Trumbauer. And in that, he did a spec house where he didn't do a lot of extras. Okay. Obviously, it wasn't decorated when it was sold. It was sold as a development scheme for Haverford Farms, which was part of Marion Golf's development in 1911, 1912. And so they just put canvas down then, and then they took the wood and applied it to make the panels,
yeah,
or the appearance of the panel.
They also weren't afraid to replicate panels and kind of fill in where, you know, if you had panels that were coming from Europe and then didn't fit the space right or needed more, you needed an extra one, they would do that. Sometimes they just do a plaster cast over it and
Makes it very hard to decorate now because the panels essentially require a tapestry or set in.
That. Well, they were made specifically for those tapestries. I mean, that's the other thing is those tapestries that Eleanor had.
Like modern art would fit into it today.
Well, I'll find you the right painting, but you know what I mean? They are very prescribed spaces.
It's interesting. Thank you for that.
Sure.
All right. Well, Carolyn, thank you so much for your time today. Sure. This was wonderful. And we appreciate it. Thank you, everybody, for attending.
Not a problem. You're welcome to reach out with more questions or, you know, if any other thoughts.
All right, we'll do. And we'll have to have you in for snapper soup soon.
Love their snapper soup. So good.
All right. Thank you, everybody. Have a great day.
Bye.